01, February 22nd, regular monthly meeting of the South County EMS. Zach, would you like to start with your report?
Yeah, I'd love to. So for people who remember the Touch a Truck event in Sunderland last year, the date has been selected, looks like, for this year's Touch a Truck event. It's Saturday, June 2nd, and that'll be behind the town hall next to the library in Sunderland. And in this event, it's not just public safety, though, I think it started as public safety, but power company comes down, Asplund Logging Companies, basically anybody. Anybody's got a truck, and I think they'll even expand it to cars if it might be interesting. You get to come out, you get to see the equipment, the apparatus in person, talk to the people that use it every day and things like that. And we love doing this at South County because, you know, people get hands-on, they get to see what's going on, but they get to meet our staff and kind of see the ambulances not in an emergency situation. So it's for all ages, for adults and kids, and if they ever have to call 911 or something ever happens, they've already met our staff, they already know how friendly we are, they already know what our equipment is like, so it's a nice little outreach thing. So it's June 2nd, and I'm sure the library director, Catherine Hand, will be promoting this as we get closer. And I'm going back to the Community Health Centers of Franklin County in the near future. We provided them with first aid and emergency response training last year for their staff, and it was such a big success, they've asked us back again this year. And this is just to get their staff familiar with, you know, simple first aid, simple emergencies, and kind of know what to expect if they call 911. So the Community Health Centers of Franklin County, they are there for everybody, and so just as we do, we're serving the same community, so it's nice to work hand-in-hand with them, so.
Where's the Community Health Center of Franklin County?
So they actually have offices in Greenfield, Turner's, Orange, and they're consolidating a new health center on Main Street in Greenfield. So they're really spearheading and becoming kind of like a regional community health center, which is their task, so that's great. We've been busy. So January was the busiest month to date. I know I keep saying that, but 113 emergency patient calls for service in January. That's more than three a day, and we've been averaging about 2.5 calls a day, and so this is up over 3.5. Law of averages, you know, we might not do anything in March.
Right.
Or we might stay at this clip. Beginning of February slowed down a little bit, but we saw a 10% increase in 2018 over the year before, so I think we shouldn't be surprised if it keeps increasing.
What was the nature of the calls? I mean, is there any trend that you?
No.
Okay.
Yeah, no, nothing stood out. It's not, yeah.
I just wondered if there was any trend.
No.
Talked about this last time, where you're thinking more and more people are recognizing the quality of service that we provide.
Yeah.
And then they're feeling okay to call, and, I mean, it could be a million of other things, but.
Yeah.
People know that you're there in 7.6 minutes, and.
Yeah, I certainly think that has a lot to do with it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a good thing.
Great. Yeah, you know, we talked about, there was talk recently, Carolyn, about the community paramedicine or the mobile integrated health.
Yeah, I went to the recent DPH meeting. I mean, it started out about marijuana, but it actually digressed into other things, and they were talking about paramedicine.
Started out with marijuana?
Yeah.
And then the topics just went, right?
Yeah. But they were talking about paramedicine, and what it is paramedic, the state DPH just adopted this I think it's a policy kind of thing, or whatever it is, their medical procedures. And so paramedics can go out in the community, and they can actually, this will be under their insurance, they can bill or charge for, like, you know, slip and fall risk analysis of someone's home, blood pressure, follow-up from surgery or meds, if people are confused about their meds, And but there is something, and it was, I didn't quite understand it, so I wanted Zach to be, you know, to investigate it. It's something that we as all three communities have to put on our town meeting and adopt, that we are part of the paramedicine, what we're adopting it or something like that, and so that it becomes part of our South County EMS. And but before we adopted anything or went out and, you know, encouraged everyone to do this, what I thought is that we could investigate it more, because like the slip and fall analysis is wonderful. I think it's a great service, but, you know, what do our paramedics need to be trained to, you know, what kind of training do we need, and what would the cost of that training be, and what would the offset of the fee, and maybe instead of doing it formally, we might want to do it informally, and but the, like the blood pressures or the meds and all that, that's part of our service to the community anyway, and if we can bill, then that's a good thing. So there was a lot of things that I had questions on, and it was a relatively new thing, so the people that were there didn't have all the answers.
Yeah, this is very new for emergency medicine. We've been talking about it for, really proactively, probably for the past 5 or 6 years. And they do this in Canada to great effect. And it's the idea that if somebody calls 911 because they have the flu, really, do we need to be sending an ambulance to that person, transporting them to the hospital, putting them in the emergency room, only for them to just have the flu? So this mobile integrated health allows for us, instead of responding with an ambulance and a paramedic, or two paramedics or two providers, respond in a different type of vehicle and speak to the patient, find out exactly what their complaints are, find out it's just the flu, and then schedule them an appointment with a primary care physician or a community health center or something like that, instead of relying on all these emergency resources. So the benefit of that is it reduces a burden for us for 2 hour long patient transports and driving an ambulance and loading the ER up, and provides better care for the community member, for those people who might not have transportation or an understanding about healthcare. But the flip side of that is it is a paradigm shift in the way that we're doing pre-hospital medicine. So it's going to require some legislation. It's going to require us to coordinate with our medical control affiliation, our ALS affiliation, which I know is going to be fine. Luke Beltran, our medical director, is very proactive as far as this stuff goes, but that's part of what we have to do. And then that training as well. What component, both regulatory and making sure that our staff has the skills and are provided with those opportunities to build those skills to talk to people in this way. So there's a lot of pieces that still need to kind of come together, but we're getting closer and closer every year. And so I'm really excited, and if, you know, we'll find out exactly what we need at town meeting. It's not going to be this year, obviously. I don't think anybody's going to be ready for that quick. But
it'd be totally different though, Zach, because now do you have another person that just comes in, and you have is that person scheduled for an 8 hour day,
right,
to spend going, and you give him another vehicle, and is all of a sudden, you don't have to make money with it, but is that person becoming, is it self-supporting?
Yes, right, know? And part of this is
a revenue stream.
Yeah, one part of this is, well, the reimbursement with the health insurance, is that right now the way the system's design is, it's just emergencies, and it's figuring out with the health insurance and the hospitals. The Affordable Care Act really instigated a lot of this, because hospitals, or I should say insurance, wasn't reimbursing if a patient went back to the hospital,
right,
for a complication from a procedure, and so everybody is working towards the same goal here. But you're right, like, you schedule it for this 8 hours, we know we're gonna see 8 patients that day, we know we're gonna be reimbursed for it, and now it's a service we can provide to the community at, you know, no net cost or something. So.
Absolutely, but that's what worries me, because as we know, you have different levels of compensation for our ambulance.
Right.
Now if you go on and make, and it was cost us $50 to make for that guy to go out.
Yeah.
Well, that's fine if you get paid to $50 or $55 or $60 or whatever, but all of a sudden you get a reimbursement for $20.
Right.
Well, Is that what we should be doing?
Right.
Oh, no, that's why I wanted to investigate it. But I also need training.
But it makes sense, to make sense to do it, to have someone just go out and take a blood pressure instead of going to a primary and or an LPN or whomever. If you could get, you know.
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, it's a great concept. It's just
right. Well, and if these patients don't need to be transported in an ambulance to the emergency department anymore, then that ambulance becomes available for that other emergency that we might have had to have called mutual aid for or something like that. There's a lot of avenues that we need to look at.
Isn't that kind of what the traveling nurse idea was about?
Yeah. It's the old what public health nurses used to do is go out to people's homes a lot more. And but the idea is that it could be potentially a revenue stream, but I just want to make sure we have capacity, we have training, and that we look at all the costs before we like jump in. But I was really excited, and I thought, oh my gosh, that's just, you know, this is expanding our what we can offer our communities, and I was pretty excited about that. I mean, we have aging communities, and one of them, yes.
You think
if we can go to someone's house,
types of certification they would need.
Yes.
I'm just wondering if it opens up another avenue for liability issues
and stuff like that.
You know,
I imagine just as you know, you could be an EMT basic and then you could go to intermediate school and perform additional skills. I imagine there will be an additional certification for this type of thing, and only people that are certified and received the public health training they will be able to do that. It's so new, we don't know what that looks like yet. Yeah. You know, we don't know if it's
just
going to be.
They're rolling it out.
Yeah.
Didn't the company that took over for Bay State Ambulance Medcare, they do it up in Canada, and they were going to try to roll it out in the eastern part of the state or something?
Yeah,
that was originally what they said their plan was. I know there's been some special projects out in eastern Mass where they routinely work closely and do special projects, and they have been doing this type of thing up there.
Once again, you're still talking about the routine going out to people who don't have access to transportation and
the
primary care doctor.
Yeah, so the idea is that people that call 911 because that is their only access to healthcare, instead of receiving an ambulance and an obligatory trip to the hospital, they receive a community paramedic who, just like going to your doctor's office, can say, okay, you have the flu, let's write you a prescription for, you know, something, or let's schedule a ride or transportation to a doctor's office instead.
Wouldn't an RN be qualified to do that?
So is a paramedic. I think the idea is that the infrastructure is in place. We already have a mechanism for somebody saying, I need medical attention, and then us responding. Right now, our hands are tied. We have to take them to the ER.
Or they refuse.
Right. Yeah. Whereas if there's legislation and policies in place at the state level where we can say to them, this isn't an emergency department. Yeah, this isn't an emergency. Here's what we can do for you. And that's really where we're
looking. But we can still bill for it and give treatment or give it whatever, some advice. To me, if you have someone on duty, then you can have them out in the community, and it's another revenue source. But there's always, you know, we have to look at the whole picture and say, what is it going to cost us to deliver this? What are the, you know, the downsides of delivery? But we all have aging populations, and I think it's wonderful to increase the service to our communities because not everybody needs a ride to the hospital.
They just want to be fixed or feel better.
Or they have a question.
Yeah.
You know, maybe they do need to go to the hospital, but when they call, there is a question in their mind, and then that way you're sending someone out. So I was kind of excited. I thought it was good, but we have to definitely investigate it, and it has to be something that, my understanding, it has to go on town meeting warrant. So we would look forward to this for next year, not this year. I don't think there's enough information for this year.
What else you got?
All right. Debt collection and write-off policy. The draft hasn't been changed for a couple months when we were talking about, I think that was November, December.
Yeah, we've been kicking this around, and you took some stuff out of it a couple of months ago, and last month we didn't quite have a quorum, so
right.
I'll entertain a motion to adopt this policy as written.
Motion.
Seconded. Any further discussion on this? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? All right.
Great.
That was long and painful, but we got it done.
Yeah.
Thanks, Sec.
Yep, I've already spoken. While speaking about other matters with ComStar, mentioned this policy, and so I've already set up time to talk to them and make sure that we figure out exactly how our policies will dovetail with theirs, and we'll make sure that we can implement this and see what we're doing. Again, you know, nothing can happen without our explicit instructions, even with this policy in place. So we don't need to worry about anything running away from us.
It's no bottom line, there's nothing that hasn't been done forever in all our departments.
But exactly right.
You've been doing it all along.
Yep. All right. There is a budget dated 2/22. It's the same budget you received before. The only changes are the Franklin County Radio System Fee Assessment was decreased. I budgeted $7,000 based on what they thought it would go up to. And I just got the statement this morning, and it's going to be $6,500. So, that went down. And then the other thing that's been adjusted in the 2/22 budget is the Deerfield indirect costs. And that went from $63,000 last year to $70,000. And that is based on the calculation provided by the Deerfield Town Accountant. They took all of the departments and everything that we use as a department, and that is 10% of, because we're 10% of the total budget for the town of Deerfield, $70,000 is 10% of the budget for all those agencies, departments that we use. So.
I saw that. Where was that here?
Discussion on that?
Commotion.
Yep, right there.
45?
7. Yep.
It's getting pretty small.
I know, get you some binoculars.
Well, do we start looking at becoming a 501(c)? I mean, we were thinking we were going to save money, but.
Yeah.
And you know, 70, and again, I'm just talking, just thinking.
Sure.
For 70,000, that's room for hire maybe we hire a clerk, a half-time clerk for 30 hours or 25 hours a week.
I think we were going to at some point.
We're gonna do that anyway.
You know?
Right.
I think this falls into a broader picture that I'm seeing, is that I know that there'll probably be some discussion about, you know, the employees and the raises. And I know last year that there was discussion about the director's pay and things like that. And then there's always been this discussion about, you know, Deerfield employees and what they have to do versus the Board of Oversight's input and stuff like that. And given some of these numbers, I think thinking along the line of seeing how you set it up as a separate entity and everything, so they're separate employees and, you know, separate bookkeeping and everything like that, it might just be beneficial to the service to do that.
I guess we have to understand what we're doing, right?
Yeah.
And for the, you know, the business, and understand what it's doing and what we need to do.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, I didn't know. Probably four years ago, we didn't think we were going to be where we are right now.
Right.
You know, so maybe it's a time that we have to revisit. And I'm not saying that maybe the 70,000 is the best deal that we ever have, that we'll ever have.
Just personally, from my day-to-day dealings, I get a lot for that money. Whether it's the right amount of money or whether we're getting our value, I don't know. But I do know, you know, being able to walk into the town accountant's office, you know, and have something prepared, having somebody handle all the employee benefit stuff, you know, being able to lean on the selectman's office for legal stuff and things like that. I mean, there's certainly value there. I just don't know.
I forgot, you know, that does include legal costs.
I think if to do due diligence, we really yeah. should look at the next step. And again, maybe that's the greatest deal that we have going. Mm-hmm. But I know when you go to a new location, mm-hmm. a permanent home, you're not going to be in the town hall all the time.
Right.
So I wouldn't think that you're going to be, you know, walking back and forth or driving back and forth every day, every hour.
Right.
So you won't have, maybe it would be better for you to have staff to do that. I'm not sure. Don't get me wrong. I know even for our part, when you look at HR functions, that's probably one of the bane of our towns, is because our collector treasurer is our HR person. Is that really person qualified to do the HR stuff? I mean, I don't know. Sometimes, I know one time we interviewed a treasurer for the treasurer collector, and a person applied for the job because they liked to dabble in the stock market. You know, that person probably couldn't do HR stuff.
Right.
We didn't hire it, by the way.
That's a relief. Pretty by now.
He went to White Leaves. No. Jonathan's not here, so I can do that.
He's listening. So.
I know, he's listening. But I don't know. I think you know what I'm trying to say.
No, right?
I mean, I don't know. Maybe that's a fair price. I have no idea.
You should look into that.
You know, maybe it would cost us $110,000. You know, but, you know, how much would it cost us to have a payroll? I mean, you have that new software, your payroll should be much easier now,
mm-hmm.
right?
We're paying for payroll separately in here.
Yeah, maybe you do, you know, maybe we do payroll is done separately.
Yep.
You know? I don't know. But we have to explore. Whenever we see a cost go up, mm-hmm. we have to explore looking at.
It's also a question of maturity. I mean,
right.
As Zach, as you mature as a director, then you're going to Wendy for less support. And
mm-hmm.
I had forgotten, this does cover legal fees, and we, you know, had legal personnel issues.
We have a separate line item for legal, and that would be like, you know, the per hourly, like when, you know, but there's... There's all that kind of that more amorphic stuff. Great. It was worth pointing out that currently with our lease agreements with the three fire departments, the cost of utilities and stuff are included in that fee. So our budget hasn't included line items for things like propane, electricity, water, things like that. Anticipating a move into a new facility.
You have to talk with our leasing agent.
Well, this is a thing.
We don't know if
you know, like, and just bringing it up, you know, and that's all where I am right now with this is, you know, how
we had some discussion early on about it, but I don't know where we're at now. We do need to have that conversation,
right.
Because. Need to prepare.
You know, presuming that we're moving into the near future.
Until we have the building, though. The building is
not. Right, like, you know, like, so we're moving in the near future. In the near future, do we, you know, whatever the rent is, does that cover everything? And then once we know what the expenses are, then we can pull them out and budget for them separately or whatever. But
originally, my understanding was that we had picked a number for, I mean, this was just hypothetical back then, but we had picked a number for rent and utilities was going to be on top of that, but I don't know where, you know, that conversation still has to be solidified, I guess.
I think that going on my own experience from my commercial properties, given what I pay for water and what other commercial buildings would pay for sewer, and the propane and electricity, I think that including the rent, the $42,000 would cover all of those.
And again, this is one of those conversations, a hypothetical conversation. I can agree with that. I mean, we haven't sat down and really talked about when we go start putting stuff in there. I mean, what's going to be our responsibility? What's going to be the owner's responsibility? And those are, I mean, I think those are easy conversations.
I really
think they are. Yeah. We just haven't had those because we've been staying away from that.
But potentially we only have one more meeting before we're going to be moving into this building. So what, how do you guys want to do this?
Well, it's more than I know, but.
No, I mean, well, it's supposed to be done sometime in the next few weeks. So,
is that right?
Yeah, that's what I understand. I mean, if you drive by, it looks pretty, like.
I know when I built my house, the outside was done a lot too.
Well, that's true. I don't know what the inside looks like.
I don't know anything, but I'm just saying.
That inside never got done. We're still working on it.
That estimated time that it would be done was sometime in the spring, March and April.
That's true.
So we have March meeting and then it's April. So
What I can say is all I did was ask the building inspectors, what have you inspected so far? And they've had a framing inspection and an insulation inspection, that's it. So
there's. You haven't done plumbing, electrical?
Oh, yeah, the plumbing and electrical, I'm sure, is done because that has to be done for the insulation inspection. Right. But, I mean, there's drywall that needs to get done, and then all of the finish work and stuff like that. So I don't foresee it being done in a couple of weeks.
No. Okay. I said in the next few weeks.
That's only true.
We have a meeting in March and then it's April.
I would guess that sometime during the month of April it might be ready.
So then would you guys think about having like a subcommittee that you would so that we could have a proposal to come forward to our March meeting?
I'm not sure what you mean by a subcommittee.
Well, we have to figure out what we're going to do, you guys.
Bob and I were going to talk about outfitting the building, but and here again, I don't know, but I've got a good idea that when we get that building, it's going to be a finished building like we see in front of us. There's not going to be any desks. There's not going to be any chairs. There's probably not going to be a stove, refrigerator.
Right.
You know, but you walk in and flip the switch and lights are going to go on and you know, all the plugs are going to be there. I think that we're going to need desks, file cabinets, anything that you need to run an office. If they want a table to eat at, a table, or if there's bunks involved, buying bunks and stuff like that. But, you know, it'd be like buying a new house, I'm going to assume.
Yeah.
Any equipment that you want in there is going to have to be put in there. I mean, of course, the air conditioning would be there and heating and stuff like that.
I know, but what the problem is, we're going to town meeting, and we'll be moving into this building, and we have to make some decisions on money. So, can you guys get together and sort of sort out some of these things just so we
can get
a base?
Together? Do we have money set aside somewhere that for this fiscal year, though?
Well, that was a decision we wanted to make.
Well, that was
to talk about
tonight,
right? What we do with the buildings versus money.
Yeah, but that's after July 1st.
No, because we have money set aside for our ambulances.
Yeah.
So you could take this year's ambulance money and use it towards outfitting the building or some amount of that, and then just figure out what it really costs, and then say split the two payments towards increasing the or what we set aside normally for ambulances. So in other words, if you spent $20,000 towards outfitting the building, you would increase our ambulance payments from 57 to 67 for the next 2 years to make up for that money, rather than going to the town to ask them for cash, because the cash is just sitting there
for
the ambulance. Yes.
Okay.
And it's available right now. All it needs to do is for us to vote for something like that. If you're taking it out of the ambulance money, you are maybe being a little bit more conservative, because it's just not like a few, you know, open-ended kind of thing. You know you have to pay it back over 2 years.
We'll get together next week or so.
To me, it seems like if you guys could make some decisions or somebody could outline those decisions, that would be very helpful going to the finance committees and our town meeting, because, you know, our town meetings are.
Now, I thought I remember hearing something like the certified retained earnings that we have I thought even though we're not, like, they're certified now in this fiscal year, that they would technically be available to us.
Yes, they are.
You can appropriate them, yes.
Yeah,
there's,
okay.
There's 412,382 certified retained earnings.
Right. A chunk of that having already been earmarked right. for the ambulance and stuff
and,
like
and
that.
And 108 of that 112
yeah.
is our ambulance money that we are setting aside to be saved. It's yeah. not, because this is an enterprise kind of fund, you can't segregate it out and say this is the ambulance replacement money.
But it's all just
money
in the SCEMS account.
So if you take out the ambulance money of 108,000, we have $304,382.
Yeah.
And what we want to do, you know, what we had done in the past is use some of that retained earnings to lower the assessments to the town.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So we don't have to do that, but I would like, to me, it's consistent. And it does, and it keeps the our assessments from having this huge giant spike.
Mm-hmm.
Because we
dropped it twice last year.
Right, and our ambulances are in pretty good shape, and we have this 108,000 already sitting
she
there.
Knows that.
So it just means that we have to make additional payments. You know, or you know, we have to pay back what we're doing for ambulance. Yeah, but.
You get an idea of how much we want to put towards the budget and retain it for this budget 19 that we can.
Well, in the past, we've wanted to retain some money to cover mm-hmm. operating expenses.
How much did we put in last year?
We did it twice, right? We did the last one.
We put in.
I think was it 200? Was it 284,000?
It was 284,000.
$284,145. So, I would like to put in at least $204,382. So, we're keeping our money, ambulance money of 108. We're keeping 100 in retained earnings to cover any kind of blips. In which doesn't seem to be happening, but just in case there's a blip where we don't have as many runs as we've been counting on.
But that ain't happening.
Our collections are strong and they're good. So I feel very comfortable saying that at least $204,382. But we could do more. I personally think
we need to wean ourselves off from using those retained earnings if possible, eventually, and not say if we need to use them or if they're available, we need to run the you know get I wouldn't go any less any more let's say any more than what you said the 204.
Right.
I mean, but I think we have to kind of dial it back to find
not used to cash.
Except that we are on purpose being extremely conservative on what we get from the insurance company.
And that's fine.
And I mm-hmm. want us to keep doing that, just because I think it's always better to have retained earnings
rather than the guy from Highland Ambulance. We had the meeting about 2 months ago.
Mm-hmm.
Kip, I think. He thought the greatest thing he thought we did was how we fund our ambulance
mm-hmm.
Program. Because he says he's out, his guys are always out on bended knee looking, trying to beg, borrow, or steal money from
yes.
people.
Yep.
And he said it's hard because there's no sanity to the budgets. And I think if we get it where we can say, and I don't have a problem, it's just like our free cash in town. Well,
mm-hmm.
we have a policy that says we're going to use X amount of free cash because you're going to be able to generate, you're usually generating that money that we apply to the budget every year. Maybe 200,000 is the right number to apply to the budget. I'm not sure, but we should get to that, you know, we should figure that out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I don't think you want to go more than 20.
And I think in my limited time in government, I feel that we budget more money than is actually needed, but it's always like, well, better have more than less, mm-hmm. so that money's turned back and recertified. And that's what we're, I think, doing with this service is, you know, where it's being so new, we're establishing that, but, you know, it appears to me that our runs increase, our revenue increases, so, you know, that dollar amount's gonna be a constant moving figure, you know?
It will be, absolutely.
Yeah.
Well, so what was that figure, 204?
It's $204,382.
Is there a reason why you just didn't pick an even number? I mean,
well, it's because that was leaves 100 even, and it leaves the 108. We're rolling over the 108 for the ambulance service, which potentially we might tap into to move into the building a little bit, versus going to the towns and looking for a capital going to the towns for an additional assessment to move into the building.
So presuming another ambulance chunk towards the replacement this year, that would leave us approximately $50,000 in retained earnings?
No, that will give us the 108 plus after town meeting, or after July 1st, we will have another 57,000. Because that's part of the capital improvement plan is in the budget, is to add 57,000 this year.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
So we will have...
there's 412 now, you want to use 205.
Yeah, no, I got you, I got you.
207 left, minus the 108, that's earmarked.
Yeah, and that leaves us 100 just in case we have...
And then we're still adding, as July 1st, we're adding another 57,000 to the ambulance.
And it's being appropriated out of the capital budget, however. Okay, yep, got it.
And so if we outfit this building, say, for $20,000, then it would be my recommendation that we use it from the earmarked ambulance money, replacement money, and just increase our two payments for the next 2 years at $10,000 a piece. Therefore, you're not, it's the most smoothest to the towns without causing a lot of too much effect. So if we just pay $67,000 for the next 2 years to cover, say, the $20,000 move-in cost.
Yeah, we got it.
Whatever.
I think. Do we need a motion for that?
Motion on the assessment reduction.
Second.
Any discussion?
I'm gonna wait for Zach to catch up.
Yeah, you got me doing everything over here. It's a little complicated sometimes.
Take your time.
204-832,
right? 204-382.
204-382, Zach. Motion to apply. That's what happens, you know, when you use steroids, Zach. Your mind starts going.
Oh, is that? Yeah, but you win curling matches, step. Apparently.
I heard that. That curling at Peter's hand is a hotbed for that stuff.
No, they don't count anyway.
All right.
They're not officially there.
They don't even have a flag.
Motion to apply $204,382 of retained earnings towards the FY19
budget.
Expense budget. I heard a seconded.
Second from Trevor.
Discussion?
No further discussion. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Abstain?
All right, now do we want to vote on the budget as printed in front?
Well, it's got to be amended now.
Yeah, now I'm not sure what the final...
Give me a second.
So what you're doing, Zach, is reducing the town assessments. The bottom line still stays the same. The only thing that's changing is the town assessments on the line.
Well, then we can...
Well, yeah,
vote
well, just,
on,
I'll plug
we
in...
Just, we, vote, we just need
vote
to vote a bottom figure, and then Jack submits the numbers to the town.
If we need to vote on them.
Do you want to change the number for the rent and put in a line item for utilities? Because the rent's going to be $16,000 less than this.
But you think the $16,000 will cover utilities?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
I,
it would. It really would.
Okay. I
because you're going to have your propane, gas, and your electricity. Those are going to be the two big ones. The water and sewer together, I doubt, will be maybe $80.
Do we need a separate line item for that, or?
I wouldn't worry about that this
If you wanted to change it, just to make it utilities, that's fine. Otherwise, I don't think it really makes a difference. But you definitely could lower that.
I
think we'll have a better handle on it for the FY20 budget.
Right. Okay.
And there's enough.
The money is the here as budgeted.
And now we can apply it to the...
Yeah, the money is here as budgeted for... What is it even under? Rent.
Whatever that rent is to be decided. Yeah.
Rent / occupancy expenses.
Yeah, lights count or beyond. You guys got on run. So.
That's true, yeah.
Right?
Don't, yeah.
And Kip's going to keep it at 55.
62.
He's got a coal stove for him.
62.
I'm getting a bad
hey,
laugh.
Hey, Kip, I keep my house at 55, so why, you know, what?
I'm never coming to
burn
business.
At 55, right?
Well, I'm going to your house for tea after this meeting. We'll see.
No, my kitchen's like 85.
Exactly.
There we go.
All right, I'll entertain a motion to vote on this budget. Anybody?
Is that the numbers?
What's that?
What's the overall budget number with that 204,382 reduction?
That's
the appropriate
assessment score.
Total.
All right.
Just the assessments go down.
The assessments will go down.
204,382.
So the difference is about 52%. So you're going to go down about
$102,000. Well, no, you have to do it exactly by 51.7.
The total assessed.
We go down about 30,000.
Do you want
60,000
total assessed to the member towns? The total operating expenses.
Yeah, total assessed to the member towns.
Zach, take 204 that 382.
Yeah, total assessed to the member towns after that 204,382 is $631,873.
Motion.
What was that? 600.
$631,873.
Okay, to the towns.
Yep.
Okay, and so can you just do the? I'm not that good at math. So, could you just do the 51.76%?
Deerfield is $327,065.
Okay.
Sunderland, $198,893.
893.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And Waitley is 105,915.
What
did you pay last year?
105, what's that?
105,915.
915. Last year was 267, 162, and 86, but that's because we dropped it twice, right? Did I look at the numbers right? We dropped them twice.
90, 60, so we're up about 38,000, give or take a dog, right?
You were
36,000.
No,
just what?
This is no. This is
math is a great tool, isn't it?
This is what we paid.
Math's a great tool.
In 17, right?
This is 18. Last year was 267.
Thank you, Mrs.
Playstay. So we're going up. Going up from
it's funny how we remember those names, huh?
Okay, because we had that second
and
adjustment last
right.
year.
Well, we use retained earnings.
Right.
And so Tom Sunderland is going from 162,438 to 198.
Yeah, well, 36.
And Waitley is going from 86,502 to 105.
Yep.
So it's, you know, it's a, to me, it's fairly reasonable.
Still a great deal.
It's still less, believe it or not, it's less than what we were paying before. In fiscal 16, we were paying $387,990. So mm-hmm. we're, and 15, we were paying $387,999.
So I think next year, after we're in and we're good in for, you know, in there for a year, you know, we'll have a better sense on what.
Yeah, even Deerfield's getting $1 million discount on a 24/7 paramedic service. A Cracker Jack 24/7 paramedic service.
I would second the Cracker Jack.
Yeah, aces.
Yeah, I'd say that too, but let's just not talk about bargains because we still have to go to the Finance Committee.
Okay, Tom made a motion. Trevor, I just heard, seconded it.
Yes, I did.
We discussed enough. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right, we got a budget.
Neat. That capital budget? Do we need to, just the, what was it, 57,000 for an ambulance?
Yeah, because I think, well, we haven't spent the money for the pumps because you don't have, you've done the right thing and not spend the money until we need to know what we have to, the right ones to buy.
Yeah, we have not yet bought the state mandated IV pumps because the state has not yet decided which
mandated which one to buy.
Exactly. So
is that interfering with us getting licensed at all?
No. They basically every 6 months they say the deadline to have your pumps on the truck is approaching. Every 6 months, and when we get close, because there still isn't an FDA approved pump, they bump back that deadline another 6 months. So we're in this holding pattern until an FDA approved pre-hospital medication pump comes on the market.
You know, Zach, I can check, or you could check with Brenda how long we can roll over that capital money. I mean, having a year or two is not a big deal, but I'm wondering if we have to re-vote the money.
I don't think so. I think once you appropriate the money, it's there.
Is it?
I think so.
Okay.
I
town meeting vote?
Yeah, oh no, it was
voted. We already voted.
It was voted, but it's just, it will...
It'll remain in our retained earnings, and we already voted to spend that money on those pumps.
It doesn't go away.
Yeah. Okay.
The approval doesn't go away. I mean, we go back every once in a while, every 5 years or so, and go through old warrant articles. Like you appropriate $10,000 or $100,000 to buy something, you spend $97,000, you get $3,000 left. We go and clean the books once in a while. So.
Okay. So, all right, then never mind. I just was worried that we... might have to re-vote that amount, especially if the amount after a couple of years isn't enough. But
different.
Okay, so for this capital budget, it'll have the $57,000 for that, but I'm going to zero out all those other building expenses that I had in for estimates just because we don't know. There's nothing to appropriate. There's not.
Right.
So
until Bobby and Chip talk about it.
And then, so once we get that, if we have an idea if we need to spend the money, then we could do a capital appropriation for that specifically.
But it's going to be out of this fiscal year anyway, so that was why.
Yeah, so we would just go to the...
Yeah.
Yeah. Yep.
All right.
Great.
Quick question on that.
Yeah.
Mr. Upton.
As far as the capital improvement committee plan, should those numbers still be left in as placeholder? As far as what you're talking about, I think there's roughly about 145,000.
Yeah, it was exactly $145,000,
so,
as an estimate.
So we should leave those in there as a placeholder until we find out what's going on with the building? As far as in our, as far as the town Deerfield's capital, or I should say the oversight.
Yeah, because Kip and I will get together and talk to Zach, and then we'll go.
From there, okay.
Yeah,
we may need to know that before our annual town meeting. That could be
the
only
ditch. We're going to have one more meeting on next week, and then we have the public hearing on March 14th.
Right.
So, Bob, if you and Kip can give it, and Zach can give us an idea of what's happening between now and March 14th, that would be very helpful, because it's awkward to go and present this as a... This is what we're going to spend when we're, in fact, maybe not going to spend it, or we are going to spend it, or whatever. I mean,
well, my understanding is, if I don't know what a desk is going to cost, I can't...
No,
right,
I know, but...
Yeah.
The other items.
Well, I suggested that if you go down to that...
I guess my point being is I can't submit a budget for those placeholders and have it go to town meeting because then we're going to raise and appropriate that money when it's not actually tied to anything, right? So we can use it as a placeholder as far as like kind of, okay, what are we expecting coming down the pike? But until we
what I'm asking for is to touch base with us before, or touch base with Jeff before March 14th. So we have some kind of indication what we should be doing. Because we don't want to have a placeholder for it.
Well, we're not going to spend the money. And we don't want to shortchange budget either. So
That's exactly right. So we need to know exactly what's happening. Or are we going to, you know, are you going to phase in some of the stuff? Do we have to do it this year, or are we going to talk about it for next year? Whatever, you know, it depends.
Well, you have to have a functioning building, so.
You're going to have to.
But I just don't want to tie up the money when there's no reason to tie it.
No, and I appreciate Zach doing that as far as giving us that notification so we could get it into that plan. Thank you. Sorry.
Sure. No, Jeff, that's wonderful. I forgot that we had that placeholder still because we hadn't acted on it.
Anything else for the good and welfare? Entertain a motion?
You make a motion to adjourn?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.